But before then, let's get started with Brandon.
Overnight, President Biden gave his first interview since the Russian counterattack on Ukrainian cities.
The president giving his assessment of whether Vladimir Putin might use a nuclear weapon. Our senior White House correspondent, Mary Bruce, has more for us. Good morning, Mary.
Good morning, Robin. Well, as Putin ramps up his brutal bombing of Ukrainian cities, President Biden overnight saying he thinks that the Russian president is a, quote, rational actor, but saying he is one who greatly miscalculated Russia's military strength and the fight of the Ukrainian people. But despite Russia's desperation now, Biden says he does not think Putin will ultimately use.
Wait, what is this? You trying to hoop with Dio and the boys?
We finna hoop out, nigga. I'm finna do a lockout in the gym, and I tweet the address too. Nigga, it's like that. That nigga play for Gonzaga. We not playing no games. I'm getting Bronny on the team. I'm getting Rob Dillingham on the team.
I don't think he's talking about me.
Dusty Stromer is on the team. Nick and the Cut gonna fuck around and get Jared. Who else? We need a center. We really don't even need no center for y'all weak ass niggas. Anybody who wanna play. Shit.
I don't think he's talking about me, dude. You don't need Bronny to fucking play against me. Like, zombie center? Yeah, dude. I'm gonna be center when LeBron James's son, who is much more athletic, much taller, much better at basketball. Like, when you bring in like actual people who fucking play basketball, like varsity, when you play college. You're talking about people who play college? Wait, how tall is Bronny? He's 6'2"? Wait, how? No shot. He's 6'2"? That's crazy. I mean, he could still probably cook me, but... Wait, how old is he? He's 18, bro. He's 6'2". He's 18. He's going to keep growing. Yeah, he's 18. People don't grow after 18. I grew after 18. You're wrong. Anyway, look at his brother Bryce. His younger brother Bryce is even bigger. I think he's closer to 6'4", but his younger brother looks like he's the one who's got the height. That's kind of wild. If you're LeBron James's son and you're only 6'2 at the age of 18, like how tall was LeBron at the age of 18? I think LeBron already was like 6'6", right? But yeah, people who say like you grow, you're done growing at 18 are so fucking wrong. I grew in college. I went into college 6 foot and I came out like 6'4". So you're not right about that. And I wasn't 6 foot, but like I think I was like 6'1" or something. So you're fucking certainly wrong about that. I wrote a hard drive article about you, King. Twitch viewer watching XQC watch Misgif's apology stream. Twitch viewer watching XQC watch Hassan watch Misgif's apology stream confused for some reason. It just seemed like a little all over the place, said Howard, straining to watch the recording of Misgif's stream embedded within Hassan's stream, embedded within XQC stream. Misgif mentioned something about his lawyer saying something which was cut off by Hassan saying something about content demons which was cut off by XQC saying he was just watching his best friend's stream. Misgif's stream could have been much more organized, in my opinion. Howard reportedly tried messing with his volume controls to try to amplify Misgif's audio without amplifying XQC's or Hassan's to no avail. Someone started playing Mario at one point, and I couldn't tell whose screen it was on, he said. They make these streams hard enough to follow in the first place without all this extra stuff. Then someone gifted like 1,000 subs on one of the channels, no idea which, and alerts started going off like crazy. It's so hard to keep up with social media discourse these days. You know it's confusing when even a juicer like me can't follow along. Despite difficulties, Howard remains vigilant that streaming is just the best way to consume information. I've actually had an idea for a type of stream where it's just one piece of content playing the whole time, and you just watch it, he explained. There's no other video stream along with it. It's just the content by itself. I know that sounds pretty boring, and even I wonder who the hell would want to watch that, but maybe it's worth trying. Until then, though, they should just dial these streams back just a little bit. That's a good one, Chatter. At press time, Howard was still attempting to clear up his confusion by watching a YouTube react of Moist Critical summary of Miskiff's Twitch apology. Quality. I love how much brain rot the person who wrote this must have. I mean, they're in the chat. They're literally in the chat, and they're like a 20-month... Yeah, I mean, here. Yeah, there you go. Thank you, Wissam. My life is complete. They're a 13-month subscriber, the person who wrote this. Why would you think that they're normal in any meaningful capacity? Of course they're fucking brain rotted. This is hard drive, which is like the onion for gaming. Anyway, I have the Dennis Prager clip. But getting back to the serious news, once again, I'm going to start it from the top. Brandon is talking about Biden and nukes. But what I'm talking about is the top of the hour ad break. Because at the top of the hour, there is a real nuclear threat in the form of content disruption. You no longer want to see those ads. All you need to do is subscribe, which you could do for $5 or for free with a Twitch Prime by connecting your Amazon Prime account to your Twitch account, where you get one free Prime subscription a month. Okay, we're getting into it. Okay, here's the 1 minute ad break now. Okay, there it is. First name, last name, thank you for the 10. Barricade73, thank you for the 10, allowing 20 people to no longer see the ads. All right, I gave you the ad break. Let's get started.
The latest on the war in Ukraine. Overnight, President Biden gave his first interview since the Russian counterattack on Ukrainian cities.
The president giving his assessment of whether Putin might use a nuclear weapon. Our senior White House correspondent, Mary Bruce, has more for us. Good morning, Mary.
Good morning, Robin. Well, as Putin ramps up his brutal bombing of Ukrainian cities, President Biden overnight saying he thinks that the Russian president is a, quote, rational actor, but saying he is one who greatly miscalculated Russia's military strength and the fight of the Ukrainian people. But despite Russia's desperation now, Biden says he does not think Putin will ultimately use a nuclear weapon. As Russia escalates its offensive and Putin continues to threaten a nuclear attack, President Biden overnight warning of the risks of this moment.
The miscalculation could occur. No one can be sure what would happen, and it could end in Armageddon.
Putin has said he isn't bluffing about the potential use of nuclear weapons, but Biden disagrees, saying despite Russia's setbacks on the battlefield in Ukraine, he doesn't think Putin will actually go that far.
I don't think he will, but I think it's irresponsible of him to talk about it. I think he is a rational actor who's miscalculated significantly.
In a CNN interview, the president asked if he had instructed the Pentagon to game out
a
nuclear scenario.
Biden, don't do it. No, he said, oh, no. Oh, no.
I think he is a rational actor who's miscalculated significantly.
Oh, no. Dude, I fell into that trap. Mr. Biden, Mr. Brandon, please get down, sir. Mr. President, get down. You've fallen into the rookie hole. You said Putin is a rational actor. I've done that mistake. Will not repeat it again. I'll tell you what. Classic rookie hole mistake from Brandon. Okay? He's in the rookie hole, dude. He said Putin is a rational actor.
In a CNN interview, the president asked if he had instructed the Pentagon to game out a nuclear scenario just in case.
The Pentagon didn't have to be asked.
The war in
If he's wrong, as they're being vaporized, the last moments of civilization will be ripping Biden a new one over how wrong he was. Yeah, they'll be like, you got owned, sir. Meanwhile, he's up on fucking Air Force One, okay? He's towering over the nuclear mushroom clouds as he reads Twitter. As he reads, people on Twitter being like, you got owned, sir. Remember when you said nukes weren't vaporized? As I'm vaporized, I'm tweeting. I'm sending hit tweets. One last time, dude. One last dance.
Recent days escalating to new heights. Russia bombarding civilian targets and critical infrastructure across Ukraine for 3 straight days. Firing more than 100 missiles and dozens of drones, killing at least 19 people. Some of the strikes captured in these videos circulating online. The United Nations condemning the attacks as particularly shocking. Biden Tuesday joining
is
the G7.
Is it particularly shocking? I feel like it's not particularly shocking. As a matter of fact, it's unsurprising how brutal the Russian occupation and invasion has been. It's war, right? But two, it's not like they've been less unhinged in the past. You know what I mean? I would say it's the least shocking. Like, especially when it very much seems like Putin is like, I'm not gonna be, you know, operating in good faith here. Obviously, if I feel like I'm getting owned super hard, I'm gonna throw out, in the words of Donald Trump, the N-bomb. Okay. And by that, I mean nuclear. And also, if you strike targets that are outside of the eastern regions, especially if you're striking the Crimean Bridge, for example, a bridge of strategic and symbolic importance, he's like, yeah, I'm going to do the same back to you, but worse, because he's already doing the worst shit. Anyway, let's continue.
Leaders for an emergency meeting with Ukrainian President Zelensky. The Allied leaders are pledging to stand with Ukraine for as long as it takes. But Zelensky's urging them to do more. Calling for more sanctions and air defense systems. The U.S. Tuesday sending four more longer-range missile systems, along with more advanced air defense systems from Germany. The big question now is, how does Putin get out of this? What is his off-ramp, as the president has said? Biden
is the number one strategic target for Ukraine and a 100% viable option to hit. Saying it's civilian is complete bullshit. Yeah, I mean, the retaliation for a bridge that provides logistical support for the war in a limited capacity, but more importantly, is also a civilian bridge, is Putin saying, well, we're striking the power grid. You know what I mean? Which is bullshit. Like, what Putin is doing is fucking complete bullshit. It's more brutal than what Ukraine did, and they're always going to do that. Like, they're always going to reply in an infinitely worse way. Specifically because like, it's he already invaded Ukraine. That's it. That's like, you know what I mean? That already is like the worst thing you can do. It's just, the U.S. always replies in a more brutal way too. It's our playbook. Yeah. And so that's where we're at now. They are the invading force. All of their actions are going to be violent. Exactly. Is there a revanchist war from the start, saying that it's an eye for an eye is the same take as Musk? I'm not even saying it's an eye for an eye. I'm describing what Vladimir Putin's take is on it, because it's not an eye for an eye. It's an eye for, like, taking your whole fucking skull off, okay? Like, his justification for targeting infrastructure is a silly one. Everyone understands what the purpose of Putin's Ukrainian attacks are. Like, you're not hitting Lviv for a specific logistical purpose. You're doing it to terrorize the Ukrainian people that felt like there was already a return to normalcy, right? Well, not a complete return to normalcy, but, like, life had started. People in Ukraine and Western territories that are no longer occupied were already, like, living their lives again. And as a matter of fact, as far as I understand, didn't even go to bomb shelters whenever air raid sirens were happening, because that's how commonplace it had become. this was surprising in the sense that, like, these were actual bombs that flew over and ended up killing civilians. And for that reason, now they're back to being afraid. And that is the purpose. It's a disruption of the day-to-day experience of Ukrainian lives. And it's also to strike fear in their hearts. And to make the war as costly as possible. It is terrorism. You know?
Last night said Putin could end this war right now. He could argue to the Russian people that he set out what he intended to and bring Russian soldiers home. But Robin, based on what we are seeing on the ground right now, it is clear Putin's strategy for now is to double down and escalate.
It does seem to be the case. And Mary, President Biden also said that he has no plans to meet with Putin during the upcoming summit, unless it's about the release of Brittany Griner.
Yeah, Robin, the president said right now he has no intention of meeting with Vladimir Putin at the summit next month. Biden making it very clear that there will be no one-on-one negotiation about Ukraine, saying the allied leaders have agreed there'll be no discussion of Ukraine without Ukraine present. But Biden said if Putin wants to discuss other issues like the release of WNBA star Brittany Griner, well, Biden says he's willing to meet with him.
All right. Robin. Okay, Mary, thanks so much.
Hi, everybody.
No one gave a single shit about that attack. We grew too accustomed to this for their terror to work. I mean, it's still terrorism, though. You know what I mean? You can say you grew accustomed to it, which is really fucked up that you have to endure that trauma, right, in your everyday existence. But it still disrupts people's lives, right? Especially when the targets were the electrical grid and the power grid in general. So for that reason, you know, there's still areas that have had no power for the past fucking 3 days. Right? Didn't we bomb pretty indiscriminately during Operation Shock and Awe? Yes. It was really fucked up. It was really fucking brutal. Which is precisely why I always say, like, what Vladimir Putin is doing is American playbook shit. And when I say that, I mean that as a negative. For those of you who don't understand, I consider that to be awful, the worst thing you can do. You know? What summit is the next month they're talking about? I'm not entirely certain. I mean, it's bad, but we definitely don't achieve whatever they want with those attacks, especially from that Ukraine has more air defense. Okay, guys, stop mentioning every time one person raids, please. It's going to be annoying. G20 summit. Ukraine also bombed in Russian Belgorod today, it seems. Am I wrong for thinking Ukraine killing civilians isn't good either? Of course you're not wrong for that. If you are anti-war, you're anti-war across the board. Like, I have my, like, people.
Thank you so much for
people in this community and people across the board are claiming that the Crimean Bridge bombing, which was a suicide attack, right? Like, which was a suicide bombing, is completely valid. It's a completely valid target. It's Russian-occupied territory. Like, they should be able to do that. But I don't consider that to be an appropriate target either. And I understand why that is not considered an appropriate target. If that's an appropriate target, why aren't they bombing railroads? And, like, why aren't they bombing, you know, why aren't they doing what Russia is doing to Ukraine? And, like, trying to use fucking long-range missile systems or any kind of fucking bombing with deep inside of Russian territory. It is a bridge, I know. Now, Russian escalation is going to happen regardless. Russian escalation is going to happen regardless, and this is not both siding. This is not a both sides situation. One side is overwhelmingly bad. That side is Russia. Okay? There is no both sides in the situation. Russia has been bad, has been the bad actor in this circumstance from the jump. The moment that they invaded, from the moment that they invaded all the way to now, and even when they are trying to do the eye for an eye as a propaganda point internally, even when they're trying to claim that it's an eye for an eye, their tactics are completely escalating it even further, because they're the original instigators in this circumstance. They originally escalated by invading. So there is no both sides in that circumstance. Anyway, let's take a look at the CNN exclusive, the Jake Tapper one-on-one, where Biden addresses Putin's nuclear threats in Ukraine.
For doing this, sir. Appreciate
Happy
it.
Happy to.
So for people at home who don't know, this is the map room. During World War II, this is where it was basically the Situation Room for FDR. He would look at sensitive information. And now we're at a period where there's another high-stakes war in Europe. You recently said that this is the first time since the Cuban Missile Crisis that there's a legitimate possibility of someone using a nuclear weapon, which could lead to Armageddon. That's the word you used. How realistic is it, do you think, that Putin would use a tactical nuclear weapon?
Well, I don't think he will, but I think it's irresponsible of him to talk about it. The idea that a world leader of one of the largest nuclear powers in the world says he may use a tactical nuclear weapon in Ukraine. And the whole point I was making was it could lead to just a horrible outcome. And not because anybody intends to turn it into a world war or anything, but it just, once you use a nuclear weapon, the mistakes that can be made, the miscalculations, who knows what would happen.
What is the red line for the United States and NATO? And have you directed the Pentagon and other agencies to game out what a response would be if he did use a tactical nuclear weapon, or if he bombed the Zaporizhia nuclear power plant in Ukraine, or anything along those lines?
There's been discussions on that, but I'm not going to get into that. It would be irresponsible of me to talk about what we would or wouldn't do.
Have you asked the Pentagon to game it out, though? I mean, just in case?
The Pentagon didn't have to be asked.
So French President Macron told me that he doesn't think that Putin is acting rationally. And he said that he thinks a lot of this is because of how isolated Putin was for 2 years during the pandemic. And others who have dealt with him, Condi Rice and Bob Gates and James Clapper, have used words like erratic and unhinged to describe Putin's behavior today. Do you think Putin is a rational actor?
I think he is a rational actor who's miscalculated significantly. I think he thought, you may recall, I pointed out that they were going to invade, that all those 100,000 or more troops there, and no one believed that he was going to invade Ukraine. You listen to what he says. If you listen to the speech he made after, when that decision was being made, he talked about the whole idea of he was needed to be the leader of Russia that united all the Russian speakers. I mean, it just, I just think it's irrational.
So if he's not rational and...
No, I didn't say he's not rational.
You said the speech wasn't
rational. I think the speech is...
Okay.
His objectives were not... I think he thought, Jake, I think he thought he's going to be welcomed with open arms, that this has been the home of Mother Russia in Kyiv, and he was going to be welcomed. And I think he just totally miscalculated.
So you talked about this.
God damn. He said, I think he thought, little bro thought he was America. You are not him, dude. Brandon saying, you are not him. We will be greeted as liberators is what he thought was going to happen. Except, you know, when America runs that fucking line, okay, and does what it wants to do, wherever the fuck it wants to do it, all around the world, is still America. Okay, not only are they a nuclear superpower, but they're also a dominating hegemonic force on the entire planet. So it doesn't matter if they're not welcomed as liberators or not. It is wild, though. I don't necessarily disagree with what Biden is saying. I mean, I don't think that, like, Putin legitimately thought he was going to be welcomed as a fucking liberator. I think it's the same as America. He just thought he didn't give a shit. The part that he actually overextended on was the might of his conventional military forces. I think that, and how much support Ukraine had gotten from NATO and how much more powerful its standing army was with respect to, like, what it looked like in 2014. I think that's what it is. I think that he literally thought he could roll over. I think he thought that he could take down important infrastructure and also their air defenses in a matter of, like, 2 to 3 days. And he thought he could roll it. He could roll up his forces all the way into fucking Kyiv immediately. And he got his shit pushed in, had to consolidate the forces back into the Eastern Front and engage in trench warfare on the Eastern Front, go back to, like, a war that they are used to fighting. And their forces were hard to resupply. Their supply lines were already disrupted from the jump. Like, it was a very difficult task. So difficult that even dumbass American himbo Twitch streamers mentioned that overtaking the entirety of Ukraine will be impossible. Occupying it will be impossible over an extended period of time. And it will be a civilization-ending conflict. Which is why another dumbass Twitch himbo who also agrees with Biden in this circumstance thought Putin is bad, but he's not mad. Famously, that's what he said, whoever that guy was. But turns out, you know, he is both bad and mad. A mad lad. He was mad because bad. What is this? Oh, Verdict Watch, Alex Jones defamation trial. Yeah, we'll cover this when it actually comes to fruition, when it ends. I think there's a good slab of ego in what he did as well. Likely wants to be remembered as a guy that made Russia bigger. I think, like, when he was also get why he wanted to shrug Ukraine, though. NATO knocking on his door, the bear bagged in no corner. That part is fine. But ultimately, it's not, like, you can make a risk assessment. Okay? You can make a risk assessment and then not act out in the worst way possible. Because if your goal is to undermine the influence of NATO, you did the absolute worst thing possible. Now you got Finland and Sweden. You know what I mean? Now you got everybody thinking, well, you don't even have a good enough conventional military force, so fuck the neutrality, the unspoken neutrality agreements that we had. We're just going to fucking join NATO. We're going to justify NATO's existence. Like, if your goal is to literally say, I want to undermine the influence of NATO at my doorstep inside of Ukraine, then invading Ukraine is the absolute worst, dumbest thing you could have done. Continuing to continuing to strengthen your trade relationships with Europe would have been the adequate thing to do. It was such an appropriate thing to do that America fucking hated it. America hated the Nord Stream pipeline. Nord Stream 2 was something that America certainly did not want completed. And your European allies at that point were your trade partners, and they still wanted it. They wanted cheap energy. And you fucked it all up. Like, I already have a moral opposition to this kind of bloodshed, okay, across the board. I'm anti-war. I recognize that every side loses in conflicts like this. Especially the working class losing conflicts like this, where they're either being forcibly drafted to go fight a war for that nobody wants to fucking fight in, right? Or they're being invaded and getting bombed. non-fucking stop or even losing energy for 3 fucking days. Right? It was just a major fuck up across the board. The Nazification was an idiotic fucking propaganda point to justify your actions. And I say this as someone who has always, even way before the invasion of Ukraine, have talked about the Azov Battalion and America funding and training the Azov Battalion and Nazis and whatnot. It still does not justify full-scale military invasion of Ukraine, a position that I've held on to from the jump. Like, no part of Putin's stated goals were achieved with his actions. So it was fucking idiotic. If you don't want to galvanize and embolden Nazis, don't invade the fucking country. Because the one group of people that will be legitimized in their existence will be the most outwardly violent reactionary fascists. They will be the genuine emancipators. Their cause will be seen as just. All you will do is make more reactionary people. This is something that America has done over the course of the past 2 decades with its war on terror. I know this as an American citizen who has been covering the war on terror and the war in the Middle East for many, many years. So if your goal is denazification, congratulations, you emboldened and galvanized and strengthened Nazis, okay? Because just like what happened with the Taliban, for as many members of the Taliban as you kill, you're killing a bunch of cousins, you're killing a bunch of family members, you're creating new members of the Taliban. And the same goes for Azov and other like-minded reactionary forces that are now going to be institutionalized permanently within Ukrainian politics. You're going to strengthen NATO's influence because now everyone's like, okay, well, NATO does have a point. Also, if you care about denazification, I mean, there's like literally nationalist, hyper-nationalist, ultra-nationalist forces that Putin is using as well. So there's that too. Kind of interesting. Although an insurgency type situation didn't end up playing out, I do wonder if some Zelensky hardline stuff is because he's terrified of losing ground to the Ukrainian far right. We just don't have a clear picture of what's playing out in Ukraine. Russia is even worse, though. Yeah, but also on top of that, I think that Zelensky is more beholden to whatever the Western partners want out of Ukraine more than his like domestic politics and his fears of right-wing forces within the country overtaking him eventually. So there's that too. But let's get back to Brandon and what he has to say.
A few days ago, the search for an off-ramp for him, because his back is against the wall. There are questions about how rational he is. He already was a brutal dictator. What is the off-ramp? Is there any acceptable way that he can leave in his mind without seizing territory in a way that would not be acceptable to Ukraine?
I don't know what's in his mind, but clearly he could leave. He could just flat leave and still probably hold his position together in Russia. The idea that he's been able to convince the significant Russian of the Russian people that this is something that he thought made sense, but now he's accomplished what he wanted to do, and it's time to bring Russians home.
Would you be willing to meet with him at the G20?
Look, I have no intention of meeting with him, but for example, if he came to me at the G20 and said, I want to talk about the release of Griner, I'd meet with him. I mean, it would depend, but I can't imagine. Look, we've taken a position. I just did a G7 meeting this morning. The idea, nothing about Ukraine without Ukraine. So I'm not about to, nor is anyone else, prepared to negotiate with Russia about them staying in Ukraine, keeping any part of Ukraine, et cetera. So it would depend on specifically what he wanted to talk about. But look, he's acted brutally. He's acted brutally. I think he's committed war crimes. So I don't...
And let me tell you, Jack, I know all about war crimes, so I'm the best guy to call it out.
I don't see any rationale to meet with him now.
When people hear the word Armageddon...
The notion that, like, we don't negotiate with terrorists when you're talking about a state actor on top of it, which, by the way, is a silly one, especially when you are the United States of America, obviously. But, you know, let's not even get into that. But ultimately, like, talking to a state actor about the release or a prisoner swap for Brittany Griner, he's open to that. But he's not open to, like, giving Russia an off-ramp in this... giving Russia an off-ramp or even, like, trying to fucking put forward an olive branch as a mediator and just expecting Russia to continue bombing the living shit out of Ukraine and, civilian territories within Ukraine or even potentially, waiting for further escalations, whether it be chemical weapons or whether it be fucking nuclear weapons, God forbid, is a little terrifying as far as prospects goes. Now, he will mask that. He will shroud that by saying, well, we're not going to have a conversation with Putin without Ukraine at the table, which is, of course, understandable. But the reality in this circumstance is that Ukraine's needs and Ukraine's wants, while legitimate, are still completely beholden to what America is willing to give. Okay? Because obviously without NATO involvement, Ukraine would have looked a lot like Ukraine in 2014. It would have looked a lot like that. A standing military that is completely, wholly incapable of defending themselves against Russia's conventional forces, even.
They get scared from used by a U.S. Yeah. president. They get scared. Do you think in any way discussing this type of thing publicly, openly, Putin's possible use of nuclear weapons might have the opposite effect of what you want? It might make some of our wobblier European allies be even more scared of confronting Putin.
Well, no, I don't think so at all. I think, look,
when you say it's not 2014 anymore and Ukraine is different now, yeah, it's not 2014 anymore because of NATO involvement, though. You recognize that, right? That's backed by America. America is offering both small arms and also missile systems to Ukraine currently. And without that kind of support, Ukraine would not be able to defend itself from Russia in any meaningful capacity. I fear that what must be done in every single part of this was trying to avoid further escalation, trying to avoid further escalation. America itself is also considered further escalation to be to go too far at certain points, which is why they released that New York Times article condemning, like openly condemning Ukrainian special forces, claiming that Ukrainian special forces were responsible for the terror attack against Dugin that ended up killing Dugin's daughter, right? Like, there's no reason for them to come out and just fucking come out and say, like, that's wrong, that's fucked up that you guys did that, right? I know, we will do it. We will do the Alex Jones verdict, but I'm talking about something different right now. Can we get to that in a second? I think it's a very concise video talking about what's happening in Ukraine. Talks about nukes, weapons, donations, NATO, and the Nord Stream pipeline. You could juice the fuck out of this. No, I'm not going to fucking cover this random video that you want me to cover about this channel, My Take, which is like 25 minutes. I'm not going to do that right now, man. I don't know what happened. Did someone in my Discord watch this and they want me to fucking gas this up or something? Stop. You guys keep a lot of long-term community members are just like pumping this video for some reason. It's so weird. Wait, what? When chatter suggests videos, because I'm in the middle of commentary on something that's different.
Directed, when I'm talking about, I'm talking to Putin. He, in fact, cannot continue with impunity to talk about the use of a tactical nuclear weapon as if that's a rational thing to do. The mistakes get made. And the miscalculation could occur. No one can be sure what would happen, and it could end in Armageddon.
And you still are.
Hassan, you really hate your viewers, don't you, lol? Yeah, famously. I'm a hater of my viewers. Obviously, that's the reason why I overstream by many, many hours every day. It's typical of me to do that. I don't think anybody believes that, but. Sorry, one
are second. Afraid of that, though, that it could.
Well, no, I don't think anyone, any rational person saying the initial use of tactical of a nuclear weapon killing thousands of people does not have the prospect of leading to something that can be way out of control.
Let's turn to Saudi Arabia. Some of your Democratic allies on Capitol Hill are afraid that the U.S. got played when you went to Saudi Arabia and fist bumped with the Crown Prince, because now, obviously, a few months later, Saudi-backed OPEC is slashing oil production in partnership with Russia. The chairman of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, Menendez, just called for a freeze on cooperation with Saudi Arabia, including most arms sales. Senator Durbin, the number two Democrat in the Senate, says the Saudis sided with Russia against the United States. Do you think it's time for the U.S. to rethink its relationship with Saudi Arabia?
Yes. And by the way, let's get straight why I went. I didn't go to one about oil. I went about making sure that we made sure that we weren't.
Okay, breaking news. Alex Jones is getting fucking absolutely fisted by the legal system, for the record. I'm just going to briefly mention it before we get further into it, but the Sandy Hook jury verdict is in for Alex Jones. InfoWars trial in Connecticut, and it's looking enormous. One plaintiff alone is getting $120
million.
$120
million.
Okay, pack watch for Alex Jones. We will cover all that in a little bit, though. I just wanted to briefly step in and mention that. But let's continue with this.
We're going to walk away from the Middle East and what was going on. And by the way, today I just got off the telephone with the president I got off the phone with the prime minister of Israel and the president of Lebanon. They've worked out a deal. They've been at war, declared war with one another for a long time. They've worked out a boundary relationship along the Eastern Mediterranean for oil. And they're going to make an agreement that is historic. We also got overflights for Israeli planes over Saudi Arabia. We got movement in terms of how we would deal in the Middle East with aggression from Iran. But it wasn't, you know, there were eight other parties there. It wasn't about oil.
Okay, but you
but,
would.
But we should, and I am in the process when this House and Senate gets back, there's going to be some consequences for what they've done with Russia.
What kind of consequences? Menendez says suspend all arms sales. Is that something you'd consider?
I'm not going to get into what I'd consider and what I have in mind, but there will be consequences.
The midterm elections are 4 weeks from today. The economy remains top of mind for voters. J.P. Morgan Chase CEO said the U.S. is likely to enter a recession in the next 9 months. Bank of America says the U.S. could start losing 175,000 jobs a month. Gas prices are on the rise again. Should the American people prepare for a recession?
No. Look, they've been saying this now every 6 months they say this. Every 6 months they look down the next 6 months and see what's going to happen. It hadn't happened yet. It hadn't. There's no guarantee that they're going to be. I don't think there will be a recession. If it is, it'll be a very slight recession. That is, we'll move down slightly. Well, look, think about what's happened. We have done more. We're in a better position than any other major country in the world, economically and politically. We still have real problems, but look what we got done. We passed so much legislation that significantly makes a point about, you know, for example, the American Rescue Plan, the legislation to deal with inflation, the Inflation Act. We moved along. I mean, there's so much that's been accomplished that the idea that there's an automaticity to recession is just not there. They've been predicting this off and on for the last.
But you just said that a slight recession is possible.
It is possible. Look, it's possible. I don't anticipate it. But I do think, look, we talk about the impact on families. The families are, they have reason to be concerned about energy prices. They have reason to be concerned about a whole range of issues. But look what we've done. We've been able to, the Inflation Reduction Act, there's more, look, I know I always quoted my dad, but my dad used to say, what is there any breathing room for a middle-class family? And the breathing room is after all the bills are paid at the end of the month, they have anything left. And there's more than one way to bring down the cost, monthly cost for people who, in fact, are struggling to make sure they have the ends meet and they have enough money. And that's what we've done with the Inflation Reduction Act. Look, we've reduced drug prices. We've allowed, for the first time, we've been trying for years to get.
I mean, that's wild. Hey, man, look, listen, Jack. We like shaved a piece in the next 5 years off of insulin for Medicare recipients. Okay. I mean, that's good. But like, that's crazy to use that as a reason as to why like people are not going to be struggling when they are. On 10 drugs, yeah. And it's not even happening yet. Like that's crazy. Now, I am of the mindset that I think not everything that's happening currently is directly the responsibility of Joe Biden. Just like I've said in the past that, you know, the good economy or whatever the fuck people thought was directly the responsibility of Donald Trump. Okay. The economy doesn't move as fast as the politicians do or political movements do, obviously. Having said that, however, there are things that you can do to set up for a better future. And even if you are making baby steps towards it, saying that like things will be good in the interim period, well, it's wrong. Did you say politicians move fast? I said political movements happen faster than you can understand its impact on the economy.
Medicare to be able to negotiate drug prices. We pay the highest drug prices of any nation in the world, any major nation. We're going to be in a situation where no senior is going to have to pay more than $2,000 a year for the drugs, no matter how much they cost.
Crazy how you're doing damage control for Joe. Well, I think you're not understanding the words I'm saying. I think in spite of everything, in spite of my opinion on like the current president not being directly responsible for the economy is like often a stupid thing that people believe. I think Biden, in the way that he's using this opportunity in the interview, is functionally lying about his involvement in fixing everything. insanely dangerous rhetoric saying that a recession will not happen when it seems like the global economy is going to tank 8% to 10%, millions are going to die. What he's trying to do here is save his ass, and save his party's ass, right before the midterms. That's it. That's all he's doing.
We've reduced the price. They're going to make sure that nobody has to pay more than $35 a month for insulin, et cetera. So there's so much to be done. And the same with on energy. We passed the look, what I ran on, I said we're going to deal with energy.
Right.
And the energy problem, we're going to deal with the whole notion of global warming. We passed $368 billion worth of help, which, as the same bankers talk about, is going to bring $1.7 trillion off the sidelines in investment. Look what's happened. Look at the investment that's going on in America right now.
Yeah. So you think Democrats have something to run on?
Oh, I think we do. I know we do. And here's the contrast. We know it. What's the Republican platform to run on? What are they running on? What are they for? They want to put Social Security on the chopping block every 5 years, and the other leader comes along and says, no, every year it should be up for grabs. Medicare, Medicaid. I mean, these aren't negotiable items in terms of whether they're going to continue them or not. The first thing they said they're going to do is get rid of the Inflation Reduction Act. And so what's that do? They're going to raise drug prices, raise medical costs again, be sure that we're going to no longer be able to have the ability to have tax credits for weatherizing your home, saving money. I mean, I don't know what they're for.
Our reporting, CNN's reporting and the Washington Post reporting suggests the prosecutors think they have enough to charge your son, Hunter, for tax crimes and a false.
This part was interesting. Let's see what he has to say.
False statement about a gun purchase. Personally and politically, how do you react to that?
Well, first of all, I'm proud of my son. This is a kid who got, not a kid, he's a grown man. He got hooked on, like many families have had happen, hooked on drugs. He's overcome that. He's established a new life. He is, I'm confident that he is, what he says and does are consistent with what happens. For example, he wrote a book about his problems and was straightforward about it. I'm proud of him. He came along and said, by the way, this thing about a gun, I didn't know anything about it, but turns out that when he made my application to purchase a gun, what happened was you get asked the question, are you on drugs? You use drugs? He said no. And he wrote about saying no in his book. So I've great confidence in my son. I love him. And he's on a straight and narrow, and he has been for a couple of years now. And I'm just so proud of him.
You're about to turn 80 next month. Happy birthday ahead of time. Whenever anyone raises concerns about your age, you're the oldest president in the history of the United States. You always say, watch me. Voters have been watching you. Democratic voters approve of the job you're doing. Democratic voters overwhelmingly like you. But one poll shows that almost 2/3 of Democrats.
This dummy literally fucking self-snitched on his book, bro. That's crazy. I mean, that's like fail son to the max. You know what I mean? That's fail son behavior to the absolute maximum at that point. Right-wing Second Amendment defenders for Hunter? No, dude, nobody cares. Nobody cares about any fucking genuine principles. That's not a real thing. Come on. At this point, like, you see it. You see a fraction of that whenever, like, some dudes who literally are defending Hitler on the timeline talk about, like, my microaggressions or whatever, okay? At a certain point, you got to realize, like, no one actually maintains a legitimate position. It extends in the exact same way. You see a microcosm of that, and it extends all the way out to fucking politics as well. Opposition research. Nobody cares about anything.
Democratic voters want a new nominee in 2024, and the top reason they gave was your age. So what's your message to Democrats who like you, who like what you've done, but are concerned about your age and the demands of the job?
Well, they're concerned about whether or not I can get anything done. Look what I've gotten done. Name me a president in recent history that's gotten as much done as I have in the first 2 years. Not a joke. You may not like what I got done, but the vast majority of the American people do like what I got done. And so I just, it's a matter of, can you do the job? And I believe I can do the job. I've been able to do the job. I've got more done. I got the inflation reduction. I got all these pieces of legislation passed. And I ran on that. I said this is what I was going to do. And I'm still getting it done. We've got, you know, dealing with, you know, making sure the veterans get compensated for the, for, you know,
burn pits.
The burn pits. Making sure.
Jake Tapper is doing such a good job with this interview that he's literally completing Brandon's sentences, dude. Love that. Yeah, burn pits, right, President? Yeah, the Inflation Reduction Act, right, Mr. President? Right? Remember that one? Mr. President, do you remember when you did student loan debt relief, Mr. President? Remember that? That was sick. And the reality is, like, here, I'll put on my fucking, you know, honest hat, honesty hat. Some will call me a lib for this. But as far as, if you look at it from the point of view of, like, inaction being the permanent status for the Democratic Party, yes, Joe Brandon has done a significant amount, okay, in comparison to, in comparison to what the Democratic Party's modus operandi is. If you look at it like that, then yeah, he has done some things. It's always a starting point and never the actual meat, though. A perfect example of this is, like, unilaterally, you know, declaring possession charges to be null and void and releasing 6,500 or even more, especially when you factor in D.C., people from federal prison for marijuana possession charges. Like, that's impactful, okay? But it's quite literally the starting point, okay? It is the starting point. The conversation, the nobody got released yet. I'm just saying it's the conversation starting point. It is the bare minimum, okay? Because the majority, the overwhelming majority of people are still locked in state charges in state prison, okay? None of them were in prison. It's expunging the records. Oh, yeah. I mean, well, that certainly, because it's not, it's such a minor charge. Every single thing that Brandon has done so far, from the Inflation Reduction Act to the bipartisan budget reconciliation bill that passed, that was an infrastructure bill, to the student loan debt relief, it is always the entry point. Like, you come in with adequate measures that you want to put forward, and then you end up conceding before you even get to the bargaining table with the Republican Party. You concede, you self-cuck, okay? And then you basically push through, like, a neutered, way less effective bill. And then you want it as a, and you, then you want to celebrate it as though it's the same dub that you claimed you were going to get. So we'll see.
Make sure that we're in a situation where we finally have action on guns. And by the way, I'm going to get an assault weapons ban. Before this is over, I'm going to get that again. Not a joke. And watch. And so I just think there's a, you know, it's a matter of, has anybody done more in the first 2 years of their administration for a guy who was, they've been saying this about my age for since I began to run. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, we can come work out with me in the morning.
Anytime. The Big question, of course, is when you're going to make an official announcement about whether or not you're going to run for 2024 for re-election. Do you think you'll make a decision before the end of the year?
Well, look, I'm not going to make this about my decision. I'm going to make this about this off-year election. After that's done in November, then I'm going to be in the process of deciding.
Is one of the calculations that you think you're the only one who can beat Donald Trump?
I believe I can beat Donald
Trump. Oh, my God. It's the same. They're gearing up for the same talking points for the 85-year-old man to run again. Is that your calculation, Mr. President? That you are the only man to stop Donald Trump? We already ran this. We already ran this. God damn. I mean, why? If it ain't broke, don't fix it, right? For the media. They literally are looking at this like, hey, listen. He's the only one. He's the only one. Ay, ay, ay. He will be 86 at the end of his term if he wins again. No, he's going to be 80 now. He's got 82, but he will be. God damn, dude. It's just so grim. American politics is so grim. It's so bad. The media is so morally bankrupt. Oh, by the end of his second term. Yeah. I was talking about when he's running. And the unfortunate reality, no matter what we say, the unfortunate reality is, no matter what we fucking say, there is still the truth that at the top of the hour, there's a 6-second ad break. If you no longer want to see those ads, all you need to do is subscribe, which you could do for $5 or for free. Okay? No matter what Brandon says. That's right. It's true. You can also get gifted a sub if you're lucky. Trinrec, thank you for the 5 gifted subs. Here's the one I'm going to have right now. So what I was saying, all jokes aside, no matter what he says, no matter what we say, no matter what we get upset at with respect to the feckless, ineffective attitude of the Democratic Party, the alternative is still the Republican Party, which they know and they're banking on. And the Republican Party, as we know it, already when they do get into a position of power, never hold back and go balls to the fucking wall, do everything they can to undermine legislative power, so that they can stack the courts and take everything up to the Supreme Court and basically gut all institutional control and run the country into the fucking ground. And that is precisely what we saw. There's a reason why even under Joe Biden, the liberties, the civil liberties and the autonomy of women was set back, especially in red states, set back to a point before Roe v. Wade existed. That happened under the Biden administration. Erkin Y, thank you for the 20 gifted subs. How the fuck did that happen? Well, that happened because Donald Trump and the Republican Party, the machine, was able to take away, they were able to destroy any sort of legislative power, right? With their obstructionist policies, they're able to completely undermine any kind of legislative power the Democratic Party has when they even own both the House of Representatives and the Senate and the White House. Two, they were able to set the courts up. They were able to pad the decks with their numbers through the by way of the Federalist Society and have a pretty much permanent supermajority in the Supreme Court, barring any sort of like externalities that you can't factor in, like an untimely death or something. You know what I mean? They now have a in the short term and maybe even in the long term, a permanent supermajority of conservative Supreme Court justices. And there's pretty much nothing you can do in this situation if you're not going to focus on building labor power and creating a mechanism of accountability and a mechanism of pushback that genuinely wants to do what's best for the people. And it doesn't seem like the Democratic Party is actually interested in that, so... That is the underlying reality, no matter what happens.
Donald Trump again.
All right, Mr. President, thank you so much for your time today. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
And I know you're rooting for the Phillies.
That's a fact. If I weren't, I'd be sleeping alone. I married a Philly girl.
Oh, yeah.
We talked about Biden, Brandon, Putin's nuclear stuff. But before we continue with Brandon and the Hunter Biden stuff, which is going to make shockwaves. Let's get to Pack Watch Alex Jones edition, and let's celebrate for a brief moment in the sea of like awful news. Breaking news: absolutely astronomical figures in this InfoWars lawsuit out of Connecticut. Alex Jones owes $229 million to just the first three plaintiffs, all members of the Sandy Hook victims, okay? There are nine more plaintiffs to go.
Fred, that weird YouTube channel with the Kevin, who should be the next?
What the fuck is this? Hold on one second. I was looking for a video real quick, and I couldn't. I fucked it up. Okay. That's right. A Connecticut court rules over Alex Jones owing Sandy Hook victims a total of over $1 billion. Alex Jones is making an enormous amount of money, but not this much. More and more, 30-plus million judgments being read right now. This might be a death knell for InfoWars. That's right, ladies and gentlemen. The Connecticut court has ruled that Alex Jones owes over $1 billion. Pack watch for Alex Jones. Don't know what's going to actually end up happening in the situation. It's $965 million, by the way. Who are you? Just a random idiot on the internet, my friend. Happy to receive you. So, that's where we're at. Guaranteed that money comes to the coffers of CIA banks that have been laundering cartel money to fund black ops. He wouldn't be so brazen in court if he was worried about losing this much money. He didn't have that kind of money. So, that's why he's like not worried about it, I think. Alex Jones was live reacting to his damages. As the jury read the damages the Sandy Hook parents weep, Alex Jones is on his broadcast laughing and assuring his audience that he won't actually be paying any of this money. Do these people think that they're getting any of this money? He says.
$57 million, $20 million, $50 million, $80 million, $100 million, blah, blah. You get a million, you get $100 million, you get a $50 million.
Slander damages, asking $1,000.
$57 million.
So yeah, there it is. Let's watch more, like a longer video of this.
From Remington. Ain't gonna be happening. Ain't no money.
Our verdict as to damages in this case, we award damages to each.
Yeah, his point is he doesn't have that kind of money. I think that's what it is. And to be fair, I don't think he has that kind of money anyway, yeah. But, like, celebrating it like this, I mean, they need people to probably gut every single thing that he owns, you know what I mean? They're going to go in there and basically pick apart, like, fucking vultures, the corpse of InfoWars. I don't see how, I mean, I just don't know. You know he used to make $200 million a month, right? There's no way he doesn't have billions hidden. No, I don't think he. I don't think it's like that. I just don't. This man is not broke. He's moving money as we speak. I think a lot of people misunderstand that if you are in a position of power, if you have a lot of money, there are so many financial instruments that the American legal system will offer you for you to avoid such serious penalties. Like, think about the fucking Sackler family, you know what I mean? Like, they were able to literally judge shop. Like, even when you are someone who has no allies within the legal system, you're still wealthy. They will, you know, garnish your wages. They will fucking, basically force you to liquidate all your assets and stuff. But there are certainly things that he will be able to do. I think one of the things that he's going to do is probably keep this up in court for as long as he possibly can. Here's a thread of all the damages. Jury rules that Alex Jones and InfoWars must pay total damages of $120 million to Robbie Parker, to David Wheeler, a total of $55 million, Francine Wheeler, a total of $54 million, Jacqueline Barden, a total of $28.8 million. I mean, that's the difference between a Connecticut court versus, fucking... A Texas court. He will try and appeal it. Greenwald coming for contra points. Yeah, I mean, I don't really care. Okay. I mean, fuck Alex Jones so hard, Sandy Hook families, hold my beer. At this point, Alex just should keep doing InfoWars forever and all proceeds going to the victims. All the rage they've had to swallow over the years, I'm glad they can let go of the financial burden. I don't know how that's going to work out. I just don't know. I don't know how that's going to work out, especially if you don't have that kind of money. Intentional tort cases like Alex Jones means you can't get rid of it, though, through bankruptcy. Even if they garnish his future wages, he has the capacity to just not work, I guess. He absolutely has that money. They're going to strip InfoWars for parts. I don't think InfoWars is an institution that's worth more than $1 billion. I don't think that that's the case. That's a lot of money. Okay? That's a lot of money. I think you're crazy. I don't think the point is to make him pay. It's to put stress on InfoWars until it shuts down. Yeah. Do you think this court case will actually stop him from getting on his soapbox? No. There are always methods, and we see some of the smaller versions of this within, like, Keemstar, right? They're, like, Keemstar, for example, has been banned a million times over from fucking YouTube, but he still somehow figures out a way to, you know, put Drama Alert under someone else's name and then get paid out through Drama Alert, so he can still technically have an account. He can still technically continue having a show on YouTube, regardless of the fact that he's been banned time and time again. And that same kind of loophole mechanism exists within our financial institutions, within the criminal justice system. No matter what happens. Of course, here it is. Charlie Kirk with an incredible take. This isn't about calculating real damages from Alex Jones. This is about sending a message. If you upset the regime, they will destroy you completely and utterly forever. Yeah. Yeah. The regime. If the regime is upset by, if the regime is upset by, harassing and engaging in a brutal harassment campaign over Sandy Hook victims, then, you know, maybe they're not so bad. Feel me? I mean, I can't believe I'm saying this, but that's ridiculous. That's a ridiculous fucking take. Yeah, the regime. What's the regime comprised of? The victims of Sandy Hook, the family members of Sandy Hook victims. That's crazy. That's crazy. Yeah, the big victim lobby. I love Charlie's ability to just take consistently find the ways to have most insane take on everything, including victims of a mass shooting. Yeah. Big victim. I just, I have no fucking faith in this system. I'll be honest. That's why I'm a little cynical about or skeptical about like actual justice being delivered in this circumstance. You know what I mean? I think that I find it deeply, deeply unlikely that Alex Jones doesn't have like a shell company that is foreign that he can, you know, that he has already funneled an adequate amount of funds to that will keep him afloat for the rest of his fucking life. As he continues, as he breaks down his like InfoWars LLC and then moves it over to another LLC, you know what I mean? You're underestimating the incompetence of Alex Jones and his team. I mean, the legal team already had an incredible fucking hurdle. You know, they had a mountain to climb there, right? I mean, defending Alex Jones is really hard when your client is like purposely and almost maliciously tanking the fucking court case that you're trying to desperately put together in defense of your client. Your client doesn't want to get out of it, it almost seems like. Like, the man was at a defamation damages verdict. The defamation damages trial, and like defamed both of the judges on two individual defamation damages trials. You can't stop. What do you do in that situation? Anyway, let's get back to Hunter Biden, and then we'll talk more about Alex Jones in a little bit.
CNN's reporting and the Washington Post reporting suggests the prosecutors think
I'm going to pee really quick. I'll be back.
Charge your son Hunter for tax crimes and a false statement about a gun purchase. Personally and politically, how do you react to that?
Well, first of all, I'm proud of my son. This is a kid who got not a kid; he's a grown man. He got hooked on. Like many families have had happen, hooked on drugs. He's overcome that. He's established a new life. He is, I'm confident that he is, what he says and does are consistent with what happens. For example, he wrote a book about his problems and was straightforward about it. I'm proud of him. He came along and said, by the way, this thing about a gun, I didn't know anything about it, but turns out that when he made my application to purchase a gun. What happened was you get asked the question, are you on drugs? You use drugs? He said no. And he wrote about saying no in right. his book. So I've got confidence in my son. I love him. And he's on a straight and narrow, and he has been for a couple of years now. And I'm just so proud of him.
You're about to
This is the same interview that we watched, just a piece of it on the investigation into Hunter. We already watched this, but did you see the story about the guy who got shot several times by a cop when all he was doing was eating a burger in his parked car? I think so. Yeah, he talks about how his son wrote in his book about how he lied about being on drugs when he was signing a fucking form.
As the world.
Not a guy chat or a kid, yeah. How would you rate the handling of his Hunter stuff? I think, like, how do I describe this? The Hunter Biden shit is just basic fail son shit. You know what I mean? And I do think he should be punished for it. But I think everyone should be punished for those sorts of things. Right? I consider that to be regular fail son shit. Conservatives will, of course, be incredibly hypocritical and try to make a mountain out of a molehill in that circumstance. Do you see what I'm saying? Like, it's almost the most American thing you can do. Lying on a release form. Right? So you support drug abuse? Got it. Thank you, Palace Law, for doing what all my haters can't do because I banned them in the chat. Like, ultimately is just to showcase, like, hypocrisy, right? They're basically saying, like, you know, He's hypocritical. Look, Biden's hypocritical. Like, his son is lying on fucking gun release forms, even though he's supposed to be, a banned guns president. Why are we acting like drug addiction is, like, the most American thing there is? Because have you been to America? Are you an American? Drug addiction is the most American thing there is. It is literally the most, like, Biden and his dealings with his son Hunter, especially with respect to, like, Hunter's actual issues with addiction and recovery, is probably what normalizes him the most in the eyes of many American families. Whether you want to recognize that or not doesn't change the reality that, like, opiate addiction or even addiction to cocaine, but certainly with opiates, like, that is unironically the most American thing. And then you put drugs, you put tax avoidance on that. Add tax avoidance onto that equation and add guns in that equation. That's America. Americans hate paying taxes and lying about shit on their forms. Americans love doing drugs and being addicted to drugs or alcohol or whatever the fuck. And Americans love guns. It's like the most American story of all time. And ultimately, Hunter Biden is an American. The only un-American part about Hunter Biden is the fact that he's not also obese on top of everything else. If he was literally obese on top of everything else that's happened, that is the most normal American person. That is the most American person you can point to on the fucking planet. It's the one thing, I guess, crack made him skinny. Anyway. But yeah, of course, like, he is a fail son. He is trafficked in the Biden name. You know what I mean? He's, like, made money off the Biden name. He's gotten jobs that he did not deserve to get. I mean, classic. Classic. Anyway. I don't know what else to say about the Hunter Biden shit other than, you know, I do think that we should punish people like that. We should punish people like that for doing things like that. You know, people should get accountability for such actions. but I'm totally on board with doing it across the board. Just like back in the day, I said, look, man, don't just go after Hillary. Go after all the other people, too. You know, I'm a fan. I'm a fan of the criminal justice system being used, right? In the way that it's supposed to be. No wonder most Americans are mad at Hunter. He's not obese. No wonder. I mean, you know, it's just basic nepotism. All right, so let's see what Biden's careful but chilling message to Putin
waits for Putin's next move. It's his continued threat of nuclear war that has President Biden doubling down on a chilling warning in an exclusive interview with CNN.
He, in fact, cannot continue with impunity to talk about the use of a tactical nuclear weapon as if that's a rational thing to do. The mistakes get made. And the miscalculation could occur. No one can be sure what would happen, and it could end in Armageddon.
But the president also stressed...
That was not even a chilling warning. That was just that... I would say that's a fair assessment of what could happen. I don't know how you get chilling warning out of that.
He still doesn't think Putin will actually resort to nukes despite his losses and desperation. CNN's Caitlin Collins is at the White House with more on this. Caitlin, a clear and carefully worded message here from the president.
Yeah, he seems to be, you know, really clarifying what he was saying in that closed-door fundraiser last week when he first was talking about the idea of Armageddon here and saying that he believes basically the world is on the closest brink of nuclear war that it has been since the 1960s when the Cuban Missile Crisis happened, really trying to clarify what he was saying there and also talking about what he thinks about Putin overall, saying he does believe he is still a rational actor, that despite what you've heard from some other world leaders and intelligence experts and what they've speculated about Putin's mindset here. But what President Biden said to Jake Tapper was that he does believe he is a rational actor who made a decision that was not rational. By sending his troops into Ukraine, he says he believes he basically misjudged the situation and thought what he was going into was going to look a lot different than it does. Here's what he told Jake Tapper.
I think he is a rational actor who's miscalculated significantly. He thought he's going to be welcomed with open arms. That this has been the home of Mother Russia in Kyiv, and they were, he was going to be welcomed. And I think he just totally miscalculated.
And today, as President Biden was leaving the White House following that interview he did yesterday, he said that he believes the latest Russian attacks on civilian targets are brutal, that they are beyond the pale. He was also asked about a comment he made yesterday where he said he doesn't see himself sitting down to meet with Putin about Ukraine overall, but he said maybe if there is a situation like at the G20 summit with world leaders gathering in Bali in November, and it was to talk about Brittany Griner or one of those detained Americans, that is something he could see being feasible. But today when he was asked if there's been any movement in that space, he said, quote, not with Putin.
He talked about this in his exclusive interview with Jake Tapper last night, where he says he believes Putin is rational. However, he says Putin needs to change his behavior, that no rational leader would be threatening the use of potentially of a tactical nuclear weapon.
How realistic is it, do you think, that Putin would use a tactical nuclear weapon?
Well, I don't think he will, but I think it's irresponsible of him to talk about it. The idea that a world leader of one of the largest nuclear powers in the world says he may use a tactical nuclear weapon in Ukraine. He, in fact, cannot continue with impunity to talk about the use of a tactical nuclear weapon as if that's a rational thing to do. The mistakes get made, and the miscalculation could occur. No one can be sure what would happen, and it could end in Armageddon.
The Armageddon line he used at a fundraiser in private, making the point there that Putin needs to stop this because somebody might see some action, misinterpret what it is, and make a mistake, even if Putin's not going to use a tactical nuclear weapon. You just don't talk about it, because that gets everybody on edge.
Right. And that is Biden, which his when he was asked about, or when his aides were asked about the Armageddon comment after he made it initially, this is the president trying to be very realistic and very stark about what the stakes are. You know, the intelligence officials have said there's no change to the nuclear posture. They don't expect anything imminent anytime soon. But he's being very clear, saying that this could be, we could be headed back to 1962. This could be the greatest challenge since then. So that's the point that he gets across. I think there have been other times during this war, where he has been much more aggressive in his rhetoric. But he is certainly standing by it now because this is what he wants to convey to the American public about what could happen if something goes horribly wrong.
And both presidents are expected to be at the G20 in Indonesia coming up. That would be a chance, given the dicey politics of the moment, the disagreements of the moment, to look Putin in the eye and make that case. But listen, the president says, I don't think so unless.
Look, I have no intention of meeting with him. But for example, if he came to me at the G20 and said, I want to talk about the release of Greiner, I'd meet with him. I mean, it would depend. But I can't imagine he's committed war crimes. So I don't see any rationale to meet with him now.
They're just cutting it back into pieces without any analysis whatsoever. I thought this was going to be an analysis thing. So I was wrong about that. Let's look at the outside, live look at the outside of the courthouse in the Alex Jones defamation suit.
We're better than that. And it doesn't pay. In the end, it won't pay for you. It won't pay for you financially. It won't pay for you morally. And it won't pay for you spiritually. And I'd like to turn this over to the real heroes here, which are the families that we've had the privilege to represent these going on, in my case, almost 10 years. Those are the real heroes here, and those are the voices that Alex Jones tried to malign and trounce and disparage, and those are the ones that speak most proudly today. So I'd like to turn it over to my friend, Robbie Parker.
I couldn't be more proud to stand here and with all of these people, and I really miss my wife and daughters right now. They can't be here with me, but our lawyers helped give me the strength to finally find my voice and to fight and to stand up to what had been happening to me for so long and for how I let
this
my
is
voice
this
be
is
taken
Alex
away
Jones's lawyer,
my
bro.
Power be taken away from me at the expense of my daughter.
That's all you need to know, okay?
And at the expense of my family. So I have to thank them for helping me get the strength, and the families that I've been associated with for 10 years through this tragedy are the most beautiful people you'll ever encounter, and their children and their moms and their wives are the most beautiful people you could ever get to know. All I can really say is that I'm just proud that what we were able to accomplish was just to simply tell the truth. And it shouldn't be this hard, and it shouldn't be this scary. I shouldn't have to worry about what my daughters are going to go through when I tell them that it's best that they just tell the truth. Because that's all we did. Every day in that courtroom,
like, these dudes did nothing.
The stand and we told
you
the
understand?
Truth.
Like, they're just straight victims.
Everybody that took the stand.
And they're perfect victims in the media sense as well. Like, they literally, their crime was to be in the crosshairs of Alex Jones because Alex Jones decided to do fucking conspiracy theories about how they were government-sponsored actors in a false flag operation where, like, Sandy Hook wasn't real. You know what I mean? Their crime was to be victims of this horrific, brutal mass shooting. It's nuts. This is the crisis actor who smiled when it happened. I mean, dude, this kind of brain rot is so permanent. We got motherfuckers in the chat, like in my chat of all goddamn places, that are still doing this sort of thing. They're still saying this sort of thing. Let's get to Alex Jones's lawyer real quick, though. I mean, that's just, that dude is just, I'm sorry, that dude is a brain rotted to the core. There is nothing you can do to that guy. I can't fix that guy.
We look very much forward to an appeal in this case. Candidly, from start to finish, the fix was in this case. We disagree with the basis of the default. We disagree with the court's evidentiary rulings. In more than 200 trials in the course of my career, I've never seen a trial like this.
Yeah, you've also never had a client like this. You know what I'm saying? Here are some key moments from the defamation trial.
Don't apologize to you.
You have families in this courtroom here.
that lost children, sisters, wives, moms.
Is this a struggle session? Are we in China?
What?
I've already said I'm sorry hundreds of times, and I've done so. I'm sorry. I didn't progenerate this. I wasn't the first person to say it. American gun owners didn't like being blamed for this, as the left did, so we rejected it mentally and said it must not be true. But I legitimately thought it might have been staged, and I stand by that, and I don't apologize for it.
And don't apologize, Mr. Jones. Please don't apologize.
No, I've already apologized to the parents over
because
and over again.
Know
I don't
objection,
apologize to you.
Objection,
don't apologize
objection.
To you.
You're going to do it again.
Objection,
okay.
Judge. Aren't you?
Objection. No, I'm not.
Objection, argumentative.
Don't apologize to you.
I suspect Alex Jones will never be silenced. He's a mad prophet, warning of a dystopia to come.
That's your lawyer, dog. This is my lawyer, dog. I'm going to jail, even though it's a defamation lawsuit, okay? That's it. His lawyer is in the fucking defamation suit. His lawyer is out there saying, Alex Jones is a mad prophet. He'll never stop. And then he's like, man, I've done a lot of court cases, never seen one like this before. Bro, you got a double ponytail going. Okay, no wonder. No wonder your client lost $1 billion fucking dollars, dude.
Protagonist in Orwell's 1984 when everything was about information.
And, oh! Fuck, I missed it. He said George Orwell. George Orwell is Animal Factory, Animal Farm, Animal Crossing, 1987, brother. Your Honor, this is just like George Orwell.
Went into your room and the television was watching you. Like Aldous Huxley in Brave New World when he talked about Soma. And if we could just drug ourselves into compliance, we'd accept any direction. Like Margaret Atwood in The Handmaid's Tale, where she talked about how a patriarchal society would use women as nothing other than breeding machines. There have always been mad creative geniuses in the world who feared what was to come. And they speak loudly. And we have choices about whether to listen.
You're already under oath to tell the truth. You've already
this was the old
violated
one.
That oath twice today in just those two examples. It seems absurd to instruct you again that you must tell the truth while you testify. Yet here I am. You must tell the truth while you testify. This is not your show. You need to slow down and not take what you see as opportunities to further the message you're wanting to further. Do you understand what I have said?
Yes, I believe what I said was true. So I don't...
Yes, you believe everything you say is true, but it isn't. Your beliefs do not make something true. That is what we're doing here. Just because you claim to think something is true does not make it true.
Will you talk to me? Andina, will you talk to me?
How about some brutal honesty?
Will you talk to me? We stood in that hallway.
I didn't see that.
Stop the clock.
Dog, they had the best. He had the best law team, dude. I mean, thank you. Thank you, A. Jones, for bringing us some of the best content lawyers you could ever fucking find, dude. What an incredible moment in history, dude. I mean, my man flipped him the bird. Like, that's crazy. Hold on, I gotta tweet something here. Look at my lawyer, dog. I'm losing $1 billion. Sorry. A friend of mine got interviewed after being in the Vegas shooting, and conspiracy theorists harassed her for being a government plant because she had been on Judge Judy years prior. These people are already sick enough without someone like Alex Jones riling them up. Yeah. I mean, what did you expect, dude? Yeah, Alex Jones is making jokes and stuff, but he's just huffing copium. We already saw this. He's just huffing. He's on extra amounts of copium, okay?
I won't waste your time on this. Please refrain from any further personal attacks or comments about the plaintiff's lawyers or their law firm. It's highly improper. Let's move on to talk about the plaintiff's case. I don't want to hear it again.
Yes, Judge.
Mr. Jones is going to be here tomorrow.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I understand.
I'm calling you sick. I'm not sick.
Remember 9/11? Politics, Justin. Didn't they just go away? They were just wiped out. And we were jolted to remembering that we're human beings first. That was number one. And number two was Sandy Hook.
Not really.
And you know what?
Ironically, Alex Jones literally was, during 9/11 and also in Sandy Hook, operated in the exact same fucking way, immediately turned around and was like, how do I make more conspiracy theories out of this? And like, even with 9/11, I kind of understand, right? Like, I get that. I get why there was so many conspiracies there, right? Because it's like this massive world-changing event, But with Sandy Hook, we knew what happened. Here's a full shot of this jabroni. Yeah, I mean, dude, look. I mean, he is like such an ambulance chaser, bro. Look at this fucking guy. Anyway.
For Alex Jones, those were the best 2 days of his life. Those are the best 2 days of his life.
I wanted to tell you to your face, because I wanted you to know that I am a mother, first and foremost, and I know that you're a father. And my son existed. You're still on your show today trying to say that I'm... implying that I'm an actress, that I'm deep state. You have this week. And I don't understand. Truth is so vital to our world. Truth is what we base our reality on. And we have to agree on that to have a civil society. Sandy Hook is a hard truth. Hard truth. Nobody would want to ever believe that 26 kids could be murdered. Nobody would ever want to believe that. I understand people not wanting to believe that, actually. I don't want to believe it.
I don't really follow the news model of covering the news. In the past, I did, but we still do it a lot. But now I mainly just talk about philosophy and the big picture, and then have some guests on, and the show's gotten more Christian, because I'm a Christian, but as things progress, while things happening in the world, I'm moving more towards doing a self-help, life experience type show than the political show.
That's crazy. He's like, I'm on my self-help arc, dude. He's not, okay? Let's be real. He's not on his self-help arc. Let's be real. I'm sorry, but you fell off. L shaking my head. What kind of self-help is Alex Jones going to offer to his adoring fans. How to not be victim to family court? Like, what is he going to do? It's always dudes that need self-help more than anybody else saying, I'm going to do self-help.